Welcome.
Good morning.
Thank you for joining us for worship this fifth Sunday in Easter season. This also happens to be an anniversary both for Jeff and for me. Jeff today, this weekend, celebrates 40 years of ministry here at St. John. Thank you. I'm at three, which I'm very grateful for. Our afternoon services continue at the St. John Cemetery. Those are at 5 o'clock. You can sign up in the same place you find the sign up for here. Welcome also to our online worshipers. You can find our worship leaflet on the website if you're following along at home. We'll have a moment of silence before we begin. Please stand as you're able. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
In our Easter joy for resurrection, let us confess our sin and brokenness to the one who is broken for us and who raises us to new life in his own body.
Amen.
Eternal Spirit, living God, in whom we live and move and have our being, all that we are is known to you. Even in the secrets of our hearts, you know all that rises to trouble us. Some sins are plain to us, some escape us, some we cannot face. We have wounded your love. O God, heal us. We stumble in the darkness. Light of the world, transfigure us. We forget that we are your home. Spirit of God, dwell in us. God forgives you. Forgive others. Forgive yourself. Through Christ, God has put away your sin. Return to the Lord with joy.
Amen.
Silence before its shearer, so he does not open his mouth. justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? For his life is taken away from the earth. The eunuch asked Philip, about whom, may I ask, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else? Then Philip began to speak, and starting with this scripture, he proclaimed to him the good news about Jesus. As they were going along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, look, here is water. What is to prevent me from being baptized? He commanded the chariot to stop, and both of them, Philip and the eunuch, went down into the water, and Philip baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch saw him no more and went on his way rejoicing. But Philip found himself at Azotus, and he was passing through the region. He proclaimed the good news to all the towns until he came to Caesarea. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read the Psalm 22 responsibly. Responsibly, after the antiphon is sung by the choir. From you comes my praise in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the sight of those who fear the Lord.
The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Let those who seek the Lord give praise. May your hearts live forever.
All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of nations shall bow before God.
For dominion belongs to the Lord, who rules over the nations.
Indeed, all who sleep in the earth shall bow down in worship. All who go down into the dust, though they may be dead, shall kneel before the Lord.
Their descendants shall serve the Lord, and they shall proclaim the generations to come.
They shall proclaim God's deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying to them, the Lord has acted. God's love was revealed among us in his way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in us who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, I love God, and hate their brothers and sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia.
You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you,
Lord. So as I mentioned, this is my third anniversary of ministry here, and since we have a 3-year lectionary cycle, that means that these were the exact texts that I preached about when I first came here. And afterwards, you voted me in, and as they say, the rest is history. So our text for today, I was really struck by how differently I read them this time after 3 years of being immersed in Lutheran theology. So obviously, there are good reasons that the Episcopal Church in which I was ordained and the Lutheran Church are in partnership. There is so much we have in common. Our liturgy is almost exactly the same. Of course, there's some historical differences, but really, the only differences are sort of in emphasis and tone. Now, Martin Luther, as you may know, tried very, 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 very hard in his spiritual development to try to get things right. And all of his theology came out of that early experience as a young monk trying to be good. He wanted to say the right prayers, he wanted to do the right things, live the right way, and eventually he came to a breaking point. He just could not do it. There was no way he could possibly behave well enough to this imagined standard. And in being broken down by that desire to be right and worthy, he realized, this is not what God wants for us. The love of God is based on grace. And to think that we can just try harder and work harder and perfect ourselves into salvation and closeness with God, that for him was the worst heresy. He called it works righteousness. You cannot pay your way into the grace of God. You cannot write enough letters to Congress. You cannot buy enough groceries for your neighbor. There is no way that action alone can bring you into the grace of God, because that is God's to give and we are mortal. That brings us to an extraordinary freedom. Because if we are freed by God's grace to live with God and, as our texts for today say, abide in God, then we're free to see everything that God gives us, including our very lives, as a gift. And rather than having our spiritual lives centered in our own selves, instead they're centered in God. Salvation is not, after all, about doing. Salvation, our reconciliation with God, the eternity of timelessness in the present moment, in the future and the past, salvation is about being. And these texts that we read today are about being. Abiding in Christ, to just be with Christ, to be part of this vine, to be part of, to grow, to flourish together with. There will be times when life prunes us and focuses our attention. There will be times when life is all sunshine and good water, one sunny day after another. But ultimately, it's by being part of that vine, dwelling with God, spirituality in being in faith, of course, doesn't mean that we don't do things, right? We have an amazing example of that in Philip, our apostle that we meet in the text from Acts. He is sent on a mission. That word apostle, that means someone who is sent. He's told to go to a wilderness road. Like, really, the wilderness. Like, looking behind your shoulder, thinking that you don't belong, there is no self-service, no one can find you. He is in the middle of nowhere. And as he walks on this road, he hears someone reading the prophet Isaiah. Now, this person who's reading is not your usual passerby. This was the head of the treasury for a queen. It was a chariot, it was probably beautiful, the whole nine yards. Now this person was a eunuch, someone who had been physically prevented by violence from having children, meaning then that he would be found trustworthy. Because if you had a family, all other kinds of allegiances could get in the way of your commitment to your sovereign. So there was an extreme honor, but an extraordinary social and physical, and probably even spiritual, cost. This man is reading scripture in his chariot out loud. Everyone read aloud in those days. And as much as he may have admired the Hebrew scriptures, as much as he may have longed to be a faithful Jew, chances are he would have been rejected in the temple because of his body. So Philip hears him and realizes, this is why I was sent here. And they have this amazing exchange. Do you understand what you're reading? How can I? And Philip is there to explain everything, not just what the prophet Isaiah was saying, but how through Isaiah, Philip and his new community understood who Jesus was and what Jesus would be for the world. And then there's that beautiful moment. What is to prevent me from being baptized right now? Nothing. Nothing is to prevent him from being baptized at that moment. He was perfectly ready, perfectly prepared for this astonishing gift of grace in the Holy Spirit to be baptized and made one with all the people of God. His ethnicity is an Ethiopian, his gender identity is a eunuch, his presence outside Jerusalem as an outsider, none of this would prevent him being reconciled with God through Christ. He doesn't have to take a class, he doesn't have to move to Jerusalem, nothing. Only to be reborn. Can you imagine if you felt as unstoppable as that? So free to ask this complete stranger who, nevertheless, you know that God has brought to you for such a new reality. In our text for today, the circle of God's grace is not just expanded incrementally, step by step, but blown up to include everyone who should have been excluded to the center. Now, what if we held that grace for ourselves? What if we were part of offering that grace to others, not because we have worked so hard to earn it, but simply because we are grateful for what God has given us? What if, like Philip, when God says, go, we just went, no matter what wilderness road it might bring us to? Salvation is being, not doing, being part of the family of God, no matter who you are, no matter what circumstances you find yourself in. You do not have to try harder or associate with the best people or say the right words. So this morning, as always, I have learned in good Lutheran preaching, there's the law and the gospel. There is the law, the invitation to us, yes, to be and also to do, knowing that it's never going to be enough. And also, the gospel, that free gift of grace in Jesus Christ. In this text, I think the law asks us that question, who are you excluding? Whose chariot would you hesitate to to join, how do you block from knowing the grace that you do? Who would you stand away from? The gospel, then, of course, is that true and absolute freedom and joy in moving toward God in the Spirit. Baptize me now. Love me now. Find me, Lord Christ, now. Amen. We believe in one God, the Father and the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Alive and risen Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. God of all fruitfulness, you abide in your church, and your church abides in you. Cleanse us by your word and give yourself to the whole church on earth, so that it bears fruit and witnesses to your love. Hear us, O God.
Hear us.
You have created the heavens and the earth. As we wonder at the beauty of creation, may we seek vital connections among all that depends on the earth for life. Hear us, O God.
Your compassion is everlasting.
You rule the nations with justice and love. Give the leaders of the earth assurance of your abiding presence, that they lead not by fear, but with love for those that are called to serve. Hear us, O God.
Your compassion is everlasting.
You have loved us so that we can love others. We pray for all in need of your love, those who are poor, lonely, outcast, weak, or fearful. Provide for the needs of all. We pray for those who have asked us to do so. Sue, Scott, Jan, Evie, Alice, Janice, Eileen, Charlotte, Joyce, Ruth, Rachel, Joanne, Paula, Denise, Sandy, Colleen, Jess, Artie, Mary Ann, Aubrey, Tom, Carla, Ricky, Tony, Kendall, Sheena, Grandma Shar, Doug, Patty, Jeff, those who travel, those who serve in the military and law enforcement and as first responders, and all those who seek the comfort of God's love, who we name now either silently or loud. Hear us, O God.